A former AEW World Champion is set to make their New Japan Pro Wrestling return, and another weekly AEW show has been cancelled. But first, the tickets for All Elite Wrestling's upcoming Wembley Stadium show, All in London, would open its pre-sale yesterday, and we have an update on how it's gone so far. AEW President Tony Khan would take to Twitter at 5 p.m. Eastern last night to reveal the number of tickets sold thus far, as well as the money made so far from tickets for the show, with its smashing AEW's current record in less than one day, and he would tweet, "Today's one of the best days in AEW history. Thank you to all buying AEW All In tickets today. Off to an amazing start already. 36,000 sold for £3.8 million, $4.7 million. Plus, we're only getting started. More great seats are going on sale. Let's celebrate tomorrow on Wednesday night AEW Dynamite." Right now, AEW's highest attendance ever would occur at the Grand Slam edition of Dynamite in 2021 at the Arthur Ashe Stadium in New York, where 20,177 people were inside the building. All in London is already the highest wrestling gate in the history of England and the second in European history, with that record being held by WWE's recent Clash at the Castle event in Cardiff, Wales, which brought in $8.1 million in ticket sales. Following the flow of positive news, Tony Khan would later respond to a false report from ESPN's Mike Coppinger, a former client of WWE CEO Nick Khan, who forgot to check the seating map before tweeting. And before we get to Tony's response, this is what Mike had to say. "Hearing Wembley is only scaled for 40k for AEW, far cry from last April when I was ringside for Tyson Fury, Dillian White, and it was packed to the brim with 94,000. Nothing beats the big fight feel at Wembley." Tony would then respond to the claim that is easy to disprove simply by looking at Ticketmaster, with him writing, "Lies, what a load of crap. Tell your agent Nick Khan to shove it up his ass." Tony would then follow up with a tweet with a slightly calmer response and added, "Since you carry the credentials of a credible reporter, plus represent the worldwide leader, I'm just curious, who was your source for this, and how can a reporter representing ESPN tweet something about a legit news story that's so blatantly wrong and easily verified as a falsehood?" With the event's current ticket sales already at an impressive number, there are still plenty of seats left to fill in the UK's largest stadium, and there's still four pre-sales to go before Friday's general sale, and we should have a good idea on how much the show will eventually draw in total by next week. This all before any matches have been announced. And right before I'm uploading this video, Tony Khan has provided another update on how sales are going for All In, with him taking to Twitter to say, "Thanks to our great fans, only 32 hours into the pre-sale for AEW All In London, we've already sold over 43,000 tickets for over £4.5 million, $5.7 million, before general on sale has even begun, with more great seats going on sale soon. Let's celebrate on Wednesday night AEW Dynamite tonight." And next, we have an update on the potential WWE return of Bray Wyatt, who hasn't been seen on television since February 2023, this before his reported WrestleMania match with Bobby Lashley was scrapped due to an undisclosed illness. Well, according to WWE SVP of live events, Brian James, better known as Road Dogg, a brand new writer has been brought in for Wyatt once he makes his return back to screens, with him revealing this on the Oh You Didn't Know podcast this week. This seemingly confirms that there are plans being laid out, with Brian noting, "We have a new writer actually for Bray now, so we'll have to see how all of that unfolds down the road." Bray had previously been working with former Marvel writer Rob Fee, who is WWE's director of long-term creative, although there is currently no word on his status with the company going forward or how the new appointment will affect his involvement in Bray Wyatt-related storylines. In August 2020, a man was accused of stalking and plotting to kidnap WWE superstar Sonya Deville, this after the man named Philip Thomas broke into her home armed with a knife and duct tape. Fortunately for Deville, she managed to escape her South Carolina home unharmed before the man was later arrested. A fresh report from Fox 13 News has revealed the latest on the case, which has now reached its conclusion, with them first revealing what prosecutors said about the incident, and they would write, According to prosecutors, Thomas was obsessed with the wrestler. They say his obsession turned to anger and he drove from South Carolina to the Bay Area with a knife, zip ties, and duct tape with the plan of kidnapping the wrestler. Months before, they say he bombarded her with threatening text messages on social media and later extended those threats to her friends and family. DeVille says she ignored it for the most part until he broke into her home in August 2020. Home surveillance video shows DeVille checking a sliding door after her alarm system was triggered. In the video, you can see her spot Thomas and run away. Moments later, Thomas is seen on video walking into DeVille's home. According to the report, Thomas pleaded guilty to several charges on Tuesday, May 2nd, including attempted kidnapping, aggravated stalking, and armed burglary. As part of his plea agreement, he has now been sentenced to 15 years in prison, followed by 15 years of probation. This past weekend, Trinity, the former Naomi in WWE, would make her Impact Wrestling debut during the promotion's Chicago tapings, with her taking on one half of the Impact Knockouts Tag Champions, Kylan King, in singles action. In the lead-up to the announcement, there had been several reports pertaining to what Trinity's future could hold inside a wrestling ring, where they're said to have been in negotiations with WWE over a return. While speaking on Busted Open Radio this week, Trinity would discuss her decision to head to the Impact Zone despite having numerous offers on the table, with her noting, "The doors are open for me everywhere, literally everywhere, but I truly feel like Impact is the best choice for me at this point in my life right now, with what I want to do and just be able to work with the talent there. I feel that is where I'll be happiest and most utilized and really get to grow in the ways that I feel that I need to right now on this wrestling journey. Had all of this stuff never happened, there's no way that I would have took that leap, but the situation kind of forced me to figure it out. That's what I meant when I said everything was a blessing in disguise, because I was really going through it." As to why she opted to leave WWE in the first place, having walked out of the company in May last year, Trinity would add, "I felt very stagnant and I wasn't happy. Ultimately, I left that day because of the way I was talked to and handled. Everything kind of just broke me that day. It had nothing to do with anything else, anybody else. That was just it. I had to go through all the backlash and the negativity and the lies and the rumors, and then to also kind of just feel lost. It broke me. It was probably the lowest I've ever felt in my life, but going through that made me reset and face it head on and figure out how to learn from this experience and grow from it and just find myself again in all of it. I'm extremely happy now and really thankful for this opportunity to show that you haven't seen me at my best yet." Earlier today, New Japan Pro Wrestling would host the Wrestling Dontaku event, where several title changes would take place. The first new champion would be crowned in the match that saw Kenta put his NJPW Strong Openweight Championship on the line against his former Bullet Club ally Hikuleo, with the latter putting the champion away with a chokeslam for the pinfall victory. This is the first time Hikuleo has held any kind of gold in his career thus far, with him now off the mark in New Japan. The next change would occur later in the night, where new IWGP six-man tag champs were named. Kazuchika Okada, Hiroshi Tanahashi, and Tomohiro Ishii would team up to form a strong force that managed to dethrone the now former champions Ren Narita, Minoru Suzuki, and El Desperado, this after Okada's Rainmaker put Narita away for the 1-2-3. The third and final title change would cap off the recent rise of new Bullet Club leader David Finlay Jr., who managed to defeat former stablemate Tama Tonga for the NEVER Openweight Championship. The win follows his successful run in the recent New Japan Cup, where Finlay would finish as runner-up, falling to eventual winner and now IWGP World Heavyweight Champion Sonata at the final hurdle. Elsewhere at Wrestling Dontaku, the Japan return of Jon Moxley was confirmed. During the show, a video package would air which showed Moxley returning to the Death Rider persona before he declared that at Dominion, the boogeyman of New Japan Pro Wrestling, returns. His comeback to Japan will take place at the Dominion pay-per-view on June 4th, with this being Moxley's first match in Japan in over 3 years, with the last time he wrestled there being in February 2020 at the New Beginning in Osaka show. Since then, he has worked 9 New Japan matches, but they were all in the United States. It appears that Moxley will once again align with his protege Shota Umino in an effort to win the IWGP six-man tag titles now held by Kazuchika Okada, Hiroshi Tanahashi, and Tomohiro Ishii, this after Shota confronted the new champions after their match before the Moxley video package aired. There is no word on who their third man could be, however. With that said, New Japan would announce Moxley's next match for the promotion this past weekend, which will go down on May 21st in Long Beach, California at the Resurgence event just less than 2 weeks before Dominion, although his opponent is still unknown. The two shows could see us get closer to finding out who Moxley will be facing at the Forbidden Door event on June 21st. On April 24th, the final episode of AEW Dark Elevation would air on both YouTube and Fight, bringing an end to the show's 115-week run on the air. The news followed reports of a brand new weekly television show, AEW Collision, that is set to debut on June 17th from the United Center in Chicago, led by the returning CM Punk. Well, it looks like Dark Elevation isn't the only show that's getting the cut, as Andrew Zarian of the Matt Men podcast would take to Twitter this morning to reveal that AEW Dark is also coming to an end as part of a deal with Warner Bros. Discovery for AEW Collision, and he would note, AEW Dark and Dark Elevation have ended for the time being. This in part has to do with AEW signing a new deal for AEW Collision to air on Saturdays. Part of the deal is that AEW wrestling content will exclusively air on WBD. As of today, this doesn't include ROH. There have been 195 episodes of AEW Dark to date, and the move to nix both Dark and Dark Elevation does seem to make sense, with it allowing the company to focus its efforts on their core television programming, with there being less need for the shows due to the extra hours of television time, as well as the recent purchase of Ring of Honor by Tony Khan.